draw a king, what would you add to this king? What is something, Katie? What would you put on this king? A crown. You need to put something on this king's head, right? He's got a crown. What else would you add to a king? Something to show power, something to show might, something to show control. What else? Yes, sir. I'm sorry? Yeah, he's got to be rich, right? He's got some emeralds in here, all sorts of rubies and gold. Again, little low rents here on the drawing. Wait. A smile? King smile? They are. They're usually happy, but sometimes guys like Genghis Khan and Attila Hun don't smile all that much. But maybe there's something about kings, though, to that smile. We'll make him smile because he's a happy guy. But I'm guessing he's pretty powerful, right? Well, what else might this king have, Kylie? He's got a staff. He's got a ruling staff in his hand. Maybe one other thing that you might think of. He's yelling at people. I guess he's not smiling, is he? But he speaks with authority. I'll give you that. But something else that you picture with the king. Something else, maybe something else with him. He's got a crown. He's got a staff. He's smiling and yelling at the same time. What's something else we might do? What's it? I'm sorry, I missed it.
A burger.
A burger? Oh, no.
Blog with the comments of above, Jesus is hidden.
You go into the legislator's hall, and Jesus is getting beaten. And I think you know where I'm going with this, right? Because a college professor has no problem standing up and saying, God's not real. Go ahead, throw a thunderbolt. Nope, still here. He's not real. The legislator has no problem making laws that are against God. God's not going to do that. The people in this world have no problem making fun of God on the internet, writing all sorts of articles, because I don't believe this guy is just a spaghetti monster or something like that. We live in a world where Jesus is beaten every day. He looks nothing like a powerful king. He looks more like someone.
Thank you. We think me. We don't think about him. We think about
about me. We don't think about him, we think about what's best for me. And what's true is that when you and I sin in this way, we are spitting in God's face. The one who has blessed us with all good things, our pride says, no, God bless myself. And what this prideful sinner deserves is to be not just here, but a lifetime of punishment in hell. And that's what you and I deserve. And so the question is then, if we deserve to be beaten for the way that we punish, and those Romans and everybody else, why doesn't it? Why does God still give us life and breath when you and I should already be punished and not have any of this? It goes back to the fact that he is a king that has no pride. He is a king who puts aside all glory and honor because of how much he loves you. And so he says, when they start whacking him in the head, he takes it. He doesn't fight it. When they strip him of his clothes and spit in his face, he takes it. He does not fight it. When they lead him to a cross to be crucified in front of everybody, how disgusting, he takes it. He doesn't fight it. Here's the one who's got legions of angels unleashed in heaven, who with one blink of his eye could come down and eviscerate the whole world, and yet he doesn't blame. There is no greater kingship than what Christ displayed in his suffering on the cross. Because that's how much your king cares about you. He wants to forgive you. He wants to provide forgiveness for all of your sins. And so he has to take the pump. He has to take the spit. He has to take the lies. That's what our sins require. The wages of sin is death, and somebody has to die. And someone gives up a crown greater of emeralds and a throne more majestic than we can imagine. He also gives up all this crown to suffer and die for our sins. So that when you and I, when we see our pride, we come to him and confess, Lord, I'm sorry. Yet again, my head's gotten too big. Yet again, I forgot about you. Lord, forgive me. And he does. He forgives you and I for our sins. He forgives the college professor who finally comes around to us in wisdom. He forgives the internet troll who finally sees the errors of his ways. He forgives all of us. We come to him, we ask for it, and he forgives. That's what he did by getting beaten on the cross for us. That's control. That is might of the highest order, that he would do that to forgive you and I. That when we come into his house and we sing his praise, yeah, sometimes the computer doesn't work. Sometimes life doesn't work. Sometimes we don't work. And yet the fact is, we get to sing him praise because he forgives us. Because he took beatings for us. Because he is so merciful that he put all of that aside for you and me. That's the king we have. No earthly king suffers for his sins. Only in heaven. That's the king. That's why we come into his house. That's why we sing his praise. That's why we relish in his love. That's the king. He lets himself be beaten. He lets himself be punished. He lets himself be mocked. So you would not be beaten. So you would not have punished. So you would not be mocked in hell, but instead live in his kingdom. That's what we celebrate on Christ the King. That is the picture we must have in our mind of a glorious and majestic king. We have to put that one aside for a moment. When I want you to think of your king, take away the emeralds, take away the rich clothes. But keep the smile, thank you. Keep the smile. Because when you think of your king, I want you to think of a crown of thorns on his head. That's his love for you. I want you to think of a staff that was used and bashed into him. I want you to think about an ugly purple robe that clothed him, because that's his love for you. And that's the image we need to burn into our brains. Because when you leave this place and you go back to work or school, you still have problems. You still have difficulties. Your boss is still a jerk. Your spouse and you are still fighting. And you don't have enough money in your bank account to pay all your bills. There are still issues here. And when you think of a king, this is the king you think of. The one with a smile on his face and blood drips down his head. Because that's your king. That's your king who's got your kingdom for you. You will not have a wonderful life here. You will not have everything you want in this life here. But your king has a heavenly kingdom, and it cost him his dear life. And that's what we put on our hearts and minds as we leave. That's what we take it with us when we go into work, when we go home. Or see that person that I just seem to constantly be in conflict with. I take the picture of my crucified king. Does that mean even if I don't get along with that person? Or even if my job makes me work more hours than I want? Or even if school is just horrible, that person picks on me? I know what my king has done for me. I know the place that he has taken me. I know the forgiveness that is freely mine by Christ.